Hello and welcome to My Generation's Roundtable History of Rock and Roll. I'm Peter Noone, and today we're going to have a two-part series of History of Music Video with my special guest. He's directed some of the earliest music videos and rock films, including Let It Be for the Beatles, director Michael Lindsay-Hogg. He rose to video notoriety with his clip for Wicked Game, and his current album is San Francisco Days, Chris Isaak. Each of his first seven singles reached the top five, and he sold over 15 million records worldwide, Richard Marx. Is it more than 15 million now? And Grammy-winning record producer and a member of Don Was, Not Was, Don Was. Now, before we start our discussion, let's take a brief look at the music videos of the 60s.
The following program is brought to you in living color on NBC.
Feel that beat coming strong. Feel like you.
Stop Jack or the waters happen. Then they couldn't prevent Jack from feeling happy.
Pretty amazing. Hullabaloo, the Monkees, and the Who. Actually, Michael, you actually directed that Who video.
Yeah, it's funny seeing it after all this time. That was almost, in those days, one of the first concept videos. I mean, you can believe it, Keith and Pete banging their cake in their face, because at that time, most of the videos were performance. That was one of the ones we kind of had an idea we wanted to do.
Was that like the first one ever, really? I can't remember anything much before then.
I think the Beatles had done one to plug one of their movies, and then I did with them Hey Jude and Revolution. And then the Stones did Jumping Jack Flash. So it was all that kind of period of the late 60s when they started, which again, like I said, were many performance things.
People actually played and you just shot them singing to a track, right?
Yeah, because at the time, because I was working in England at the time, the only people who were big enough were the Beatles and the Stones, who could do their videos, because otherwise the shows, what many of them were doing was just putting on the plug shows to plug the record. And the shows wouldn't have you on unless you were powerful enough to say, I'm not going to go on, I'm not going to perform in public. And the Beatles had really stopped performing. And so that's why when they came with Hey Jude and with Revolution, they wanted to do that. And the Stones, because there was that rivalry at the time between the two, and the Stones thought, well, if the Beatles aren't going to do it, then we're not going to do it either. So they wanted to do it. And they also thought they could get, it would look a little better than the shows at the time. Because the only really good show in England at the time, in my opinion, was Ready, Steady, Go, which I did when you and I first met. And the other shows were much duller to look at. And so we always thought we could get a better look if we actually shot it ourselves.
Absolutely.
Yes, we did.
Yeah, that's great. That was about the first one I ever remember. Don, what was the first time you ever saw a rock group on the television?
Well, I remember seeing some of those, not in video form, but in actual...
You know, rock bands on the television in any form.
It's you know, somewhere in the Ed Sullivan, you know, period. Probably was you.
No. But, can you remember that far back? 64, 65?
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay, good.
I went
man.
To see you at the Cobo Hall in Detroit, Michigan, twice.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow, good for you. You obviously have very good taste in music. And it's shown over throughout your career. How about you?
Well, you know, the Monkees were, you know, I was born in 63.
Right.
And so, I mean, I'm ashamed to admit this, but I didn't really catch up to the Beatles until I was a little bit older and I kind of got poured through all the old records that my dad had bought. But I was a Monkees freak.
So really?
But you know, when I was looking at that clip just then of Daydream Believer, I mean, it was a video, and like we have videos now, but nobody really thought of it like that.
Well, it was actually a piece of the TV show that was pulled out, and then it became a video.
Right.
Most of the videos from the period are things from TV
shows.
But
that was, you know, in the mid to in the later 60s, that's when I first started to become aware of music really being that visual. Because Elvis, you had to go see.
Right.
Or if you caught him on the Ed Sullivan Show or something. You know?
Right, I mean, exactly. How about you, Chris? What was the first time you ever saw a rock act on television?
Oh, I don't know the first time. I just want to first of all say, looking at that, I just think that there's proof there that what a lot of people have said for years, that Mickey Dolenz is really a genius. And I think...
I can do a good impersonation of Mickey Dolenz.
I think he's a genius, kind of a comic genius, but in the same fashion as like Jerry Lewis or something. I think that someday people are going to really look at his work as genius work, and that's proof of it. Past that, the first thing that I can remember back is probably seeing Roy Orbison on TV and singing Pretty Woman.
Yeah.
Which was?
Somewhere in the 60s.
Yeah, and pretty exciting, because he was wearing dark glasses on TV, which really, you know, if you're brought up in a white trash family, you're taught not to wear your dark glasses, you know, like inside.
Oh, okay.
You weren't. So, right. Of course, you're a registered rock star now. You can do what you want.
I think he started that in England.
But I thought that was pretty tough. Like, you know, I wanted to go to school and wear dark glasses then.
So, Don, do you think rock music translates well to television? Is it a good medium?
Tell the truth.
Well, you know, when I wonder how much rock music has to change for television. I always wonder about the point where you can reach more people via some mass media than you can by going around and playing concerts and doing what you naturally do. How does that alter your music?
But real big people in rock and roll don't even go on the shows anymore.
Sure, no. Because that's what I say on TV. Mm-hmm.
You mean like right now I don't see... Madonna doesn't come and do MTV.
Live.
No, she wouldn't. She wouldn't come and do like... She wouldn't do like a live...
And that's why,
like
when Springsteen showed up on the last NBC Letterman show, that's why it was so... Because you never see... Well, Bruce Springsteen is not going to show up in a talk show. So when he did, it was drama.
Yeah.
So
and
Don,
it actually sounded great.
Yeah, that sounded very good, that show. Yeah.
Don, do you think that's because they've become these video monsters now who don't play live all the time? I mean, once upon a time, it was really good fun to go on Ready, Steady, Go and Ed Sullivan and play live and try and impress all your peers, you know?
I think it's a big problem in music. For example... I, you know, having grown up watching Ed Sullivan, and just a moment like maybe where Mick Jagger wore a sweatshirt out instead of a suit, man, that was a highly rebellious, and it was a very rebellious statement. It really incited a lot of kids. For a kid to watch Ed Sullivan and wait for the rock and roll bands to come on, that was kind of like going to church on Sunday night.
Okay, we have to take a short break, but we'll be right back on My Generation with more stories about videos. Welcome back to My Generation's Roundtable History of Rock and Roll, where today our topic is music videos, with my special guests, Michael Lindsay-Hogg, Chris Isaak, Richard Marx, and Don Was. And I'm Peter Noone. Before we go on with our me decade discussing the 70s videos, let's take a look at this music video of the 70s.
How the others must see the faker, much too fast to take that test.
Mamma mia,
mamma mia, let me go. Beelzebub has the devil put aside for me, for me, for me.
So there we have it, 70s videos. I like the Bowie one. I think the first one that was ever a smash record because of video was probably the Bohemian Rhapsody. I remember seeing that and going, wow, that's a music video.
That was directed by a friend of mine, Bruce Gowers, who's done a lot of wonderful work, who used to be a cameraman in Ready, Steady, Go. I mean, just to keep the line going, he did Bohemian Rhapsody. And it was one of the first visual concept rock and roll videos, I think. Because prior to that, just backtracking for a second, is that normally it was just the performance which you were getting from the people because they didn't want to do it. And any kind of concept idea costs more money. And since basically it was just trying to do as many songs as you could for as little amount of money as you can to kind of get them around the world, no one wanted to spend that little bit more money. And so then when this happened, that was broke a lot of ground, that one that Bruce did, because it was also so good.
Right.
Richard, what were some other bands who did videos in the 70s?
Well, you know, I was just thinking about one of the earliest quotes videos, like a concept video that I ever saw, was Rod Stewart's Tonight's the Night, where he's sitting in a mansion with Britt Eklund, and it had to be, what's that record, 76, 77, something like that?
Yeah.
And I remember that was, I mean, I always thought Rod was cool, because let's face it, he's cool. But that was the first time, it was pretty racy, actually, for the time. Mm-hmm. I mean, I didn't see anything on TV, I was, you know, in my early teens, and I remember thinking, you know, he's got Britt Eklund laid out in the bed, and he's doing his thing. But that wasn't
that,
like
that's
a
euphemism?
Yeah, doing his thing. Okay. You know what that, you know what the thing is?
What is a euphemism?
Okay. Go look that up, will you?
That's not my euphemism.
Yeah. So that was a real sort of concept video. I mean, you probably look, you know, if you look at it now, it looks like it was made for like
good
$150. But yeah, great concept.
Brett Eklund on a bed doing your thing.
Yeah.
Actually,
I worked a long time on that concept.
Yeah, I think,
I think
there's this guy called Chris Isaak who's been known to like be in a video like with a woman. Did you copy that from that Rod Stewart video?
I think people haven't advanced that much, probably. It's going to be 50 years from now, it'll be the same thing.
Yeah. Except that Rod actually got to do it. Well, I don't know. Maybe you got to do your thing, too.
Michael, why did they start making them?
They started...
You'll know.
The current answer.
I know.
I don't know. I was only making them because they were fun, fun to do, and I got paid. That's why I did it. I don't know why, because the problem was the outlet, because until MTV came along, there was only like Midnight Special, and there was some places in England, some places, I don't know where it was, but it was, they didn't want to perform, they wanted to plug the record, I guess. They didn't want to perform, they wanted to plug the record, and the rich bands, because early on, the rich bands paid for their own, they didn't even get it from the record company. And also, like, for example, the Rolling Stones, they wanted to make money off their videos. So if we made a video for like $40,000, they wanted to get their $40,000 back and then sell records on top of that. You know? To do with videos at the time, we did one which was good to look at, which is only rock and roll, which was them in a tent wearing sailor suits full of We Wanted Mud, but it turned out to be bubbles. What they wanted to do was some way of making you remember the song and not just performing anymore. So partly maybe to do with the time that Bruce did Bohemian Rhapsody, but it was somehow, which very much translates into, I think what happens in MTV, is attaching certain images to those lyrics and those licks, and hoping that by attaching those images, more people would remember the song and therefore buy the song.
So when MTV came along, where were you? What did you think of it when it came along?
You know, I didn't have it because you had cable vision, but I went over to my friend's house, had it, and I was watching, I was going, wow, it was like you could see the Stray Cats and the Go-Go's, and your regular radio channels were not playing those bands. And so you felt, this is pretty hip.
Right.
And now, you pretty much on anything you watch on TV, it's, you watch the same things you see on TV or what you hear on radio, pretty much.
From what I remember, actually, and what people have told me that are in the music business, is that at that time, maybe you guys know, you can prove this right
he
or
knows.
Wrong. He knows.
He knows.
Weren't record sales just like the worst? Wasn't that like the worst time for the record business at that time? Weren't, like, at the end of the 70s, beginning of 80s, it seemed like no one was buying records. It was the music business was just really in dire straits. And then this new thing came along called MTV, which was made music visual, and all of a sudden it started to like hype record sales, and people started to get excited about popular music again. And I think that for that reason alone, if it gave music a shot of adrenaline, then bravo.
Great.
And then, you know, somewhere in the middle of that, I think the point got lost for me.
Right.
And I think that it's now it's just more of the corporate machine, and it's all about, well, now radio stations, some radio stations won't play you unless your video's X number on MTV or whatever. You know, I mean, that's not the way it should be. It should always be about the music, first and foremost.
Right.
That's why so many, you know, talented artists can't get arrested because they don't look right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, would the Eagles have gotten a deal, or
they,
would?
But they could get arrested.
They could, yeah, that's true. They could have gotten arrested. But I mean, would Procol Harum have existed if it was all about videos?
Absolutely not.
No.
So, you know.
How about you, Don? Where were you?
Well, I was not wired up, just like Chris. I didn't see it for the first couple of years, but I got the sense of the fact that something adventurous was going on, and I think that the fact that it ultimately was co-opted and corrupt is a little strong, but you know that the essence got washed out of that first thing is right in keeping with the history of popular music, that transcending even the birth of rock and roll, really, that somehow you get something that's really fresh and exciting and usually ethnic, and in America usually black,
right.
And then the intelligentsia latches onto it and starts taking it as their own, and then from the intelligentsia come the business people who totally miss the point and take the essence of it away and reduce it to its lowest common denominator for mass consumption.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's a bad thing, right?
We got intelligentsia, we got euphemism. Yeah. Okay, I think it's my turn next. Go ahead.
No, I think we're going to have to take a small break, but we'll be right back with more on our history of the music video. Peter Noone back with you on My Generation's Roundtable, History of Rock and Roll. And today's subject is the music video with my special guests, Michael Lindsay-Hogg, Chris Isaak, Richard Marx, and Don Was. And to a certain extent, the rock video started with rock movies. Let's take a look at rock movies of the 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s. So there we have it, rock films from Elvis to Spinal Tap. Do you have any favorite, Don, do you have any favorite rock films?
Well,
they don't have to be from the 70s. I know you've forgotten the 70s completely.
I'm blank. No, but that Spinal Tap, man, is like the ultimate, isn't it? Everyone's got that on their bus, and no one laughs because it's the truth.
Well, it happens every day on the road.
Every band on tour.
But it didn't, yeah.
What's your favorite rock video, Chris? Rock movie, I mean.
I think, was it Girl Can't Help It? That, you know,
yeah,
that one, right?
Yeah. It's got Gene Vincent in it.
Yeah, Gene Vincent's in it.
Yeah.
And it's got, was it Harold on the drums? The drummer on that is like just, he's a killer.
Harold? That's before my time. Harold.
Harold.
That's not Harold.
Oh, okay.
But I met their drummer since then.
Okay.
The Gene Vincent's drummer, and it's like, it's very much a band, and it's like, it's a cool movie, and it's got a lot of, you remember the opening scene?
It's tell us about it. Won't
tell
you?
Us the opening scene, Chris. We've forgotten it. You know, I mean, right. I saw it when I was a kid, but
you see it, you'd remember it. It's this girl walking down the street. Who is it? Jane Mansfield's in it, and she's walking down the street. They got her cinched into a dress. It's like about this big at the waist, and then she's got two milk bottles carrying them, walking down the street like this.
God bless her.
And she walks by like people, and as she walks by a guy with ice, like all the ice melts. And that's what they're singing, The Girl Can't Help It.
That's great.
It's kind of a video right there, you know, it's a concept video.
Okay, well, we're going to play it then. We'll play it on the next My Generation. How about you, Michael? What's your favorite rock movie?
Yeah, I don't know. It was great to see that Elvis clip. We were just saying as we were watching it how great he looked, great shoes.
How could he go from that to Clambake?
I don't know. That was one of the best clips ever, that one.
He just kept getting better. I know.
I kind of forget what the other ones were. They made a couple in England at the time. Ringo was in one, I think Keith Moon was in another. Dave Clark did a good one in 1903.
Right.
Called Catch Us If You Can.
It was called something else over here. It was called Having a Wild Weekend.
Having a Wild Weekend.
It wasn't on film, that was a series of stones that you flipped through, right?
Well, all English bands just ran away from somebody through all the
exactly.
movies.
Running down sand dunes.
Yeah, running away from the fans.
And then Summer Let It Be, obviously, I'm very partial to some of that. And then, I don't know, and then what other ones have there been?
Do you know it's a great movie that never came out? It's Eat the Document, the Bob Dylan
movie
that was the follow-up to Don't Look Back.
Well, there were great ones. I mean, there was Don't Look Back, Let It Be, your movie, Last Waltz.
Last Waltz was great.
Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band.
Hard Day's Night.
Yes.
Hard Day's Night wasn't too bad.
Or Loving You. Elvis Loving You. That's
I love
cool
that one.
Tommy. Ken Russell's kind of bizarre. Tommy. Mm.
There were some really lousy ones, though. I mean, I like the Bee Gees and I like Peter Frampton, but that was probably the worst moment in rock movie history.
Sergeant Faster Pepper's Pussycat, Heart. Kill, Kill, Kill. Well, that really didn't have music in it, but it was a damn good movie.
Oh,
still,
there's lots
worth
of good
seeing.
So what do you think, what's going to make a good movie soundtrack? Is there such a thing? I mean, I remember there were movies that used great soundtracks. Like I think the first one I remember was The Graduate, where there weren't actually rock and roll singers in it, but they had this wonderful thing going up. That's another way, is that?
Sure, I think American Graffiti had a great track, which was music at the time.
I think the only way it's going to happen is when the music in films is not just to sell soundtrack albums, it's really to, like The Graduate, the music was such an integral part of the film itself. Mm. You know, I mean, I'm sure we've all been offered, you know, hey, write a song for this movie, just write us a hit song, as if any of us know what that is. Mm. You know, I mean, like anybody can sit down and go, oh yeah, here we go. But it's not about, well, what's the movie about, or how is this gonna affect the scene in the movie? It's all about, well, how many soundtrack albums gonna sell? And I think if you can't get beyond that, then it's all going in the wrong direction.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, we've run out of time. I'm sorry to interrupt you guys, but we've run out of time. But don't forget to watch up.
What about the lightning round?
We're going to do that afterwards.
I studied for the lightning round.
We'll have that later. Round? Don't forget to watch our second installment, My Generation Videos. Peter Noone, thank you, and thank you for my guests. Hope you
thank
watch
you.
Us. Bye. Hello and welcome to My Generation's Roundtable History of Rock and Roll. I'm Peter Noone, and today's show I'll be joined by... He's directed some of the earliest music videos and rock films, including Let It Be for the Beatles, director Michael Lindsay-Hogg. He rose to video notoriety with his clip for Wicked Game, and his current album is San Francisco Days, Chris Isaak. Each of his first seven singles reached the top five, and he sold over 15 million records worldwide, Richard Marx. Grammy Award-winning record producer and member of the group Was Not Was, Don Was. And later in our show, we'll be joined via satellite by Todd Rundgren. So we'll be starting off the show exactly where we finished the last show, talking about music videos, only now at the beginning of a new era, the 80s.
Four, we've gone for main engine start. We have main engine start.
Ladies and gentlemen, rock and roll.
This is it. Welcome to MTV Music Television, the world's first 24-hour stereo video music channel. Now, starting right now, you'll never look at music the same way again.
Video killed the radio star. 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 Video killed the radio star.
So Chris, that was a pretty prophetic or pathetic statement by Mark Goodman. What do you think of that?
I didn't know. I thought he was the guy who sold that music late at night. And now I remember he was on there.
So Michael, what exactly are videos? Are they commercials for records or are they artistic statements?
I think they're both. I think they've become more commercials for records because I think, like we were saying before, I mean, MTV has changed so much in it since it started in the last 5, 6, 7 years. It's changed so much. But I also think as far as the performer is concerned, that although they want to sell records, but they don't want to think they're doing some piece of crap. I mean, they want to do something which is interesting for them to take part in and how they spend their time and what the concept is. So I think they can be both. The trouble is a lot of the imagery has been so used and reused and reused again that it doesn't have much vibrancy anymore. Mm-hmm. I think, but it we're in part of, I mean, that's probably what Todd Rundgren is also going to come and talk to us about, is that things are changing so much and so fast, you know, as you go into this, you know, I mean, there are people alive who were born, you know, before there were airplanes, let alone people landing on the moon. I mean, if you think of the century we're in, who knows what's going to happen? I mean, it's very hard to think of music now being detached from images, but like, I like Los Lobos, and I don't see them on MTV very much, but I listen to the music a lot. You know?
Yeah.
Mm.
They have been on MTV. I think that's what.
Yeah, they have, but I mean, they're not in heavy rotation.
Yeah, they don't have a little Slovos weekend.
Yeah, they should.
Which I propose starting right now. Yeah. Yeah. You get a little Slovos weekend.
So, did any music videos ever actually destroy an act or harm their career? Like Springsteen, maybe for a while there.
No, I don't think so.
No.
They might come back. You know what's funny is that once they have a video of you and. Like looking really ridiculous, and you're right in, you know, bell bottoms, and you got your hair just the right way, and then 10 years later, that's the worst thing in the world. I mean, then they come back and play at heavy rotation of you looking totally out of style. So that way it can come around.
I think it can kill a record. I mean, I've been one of those bands that been on top of the pops, and the record went down the next week because you know, they thought it was a bunch of young kids up to playing, and then here come these. Rats from Detroit and record drops. You know, it's
Rats from Detroit. You're tough on yourself, my friend. Come on, man. You're a good-looking fellow.
I know a band who, when they're in the studio creating the song and they start in the beginnings of the song, they go, "I can see the video now. We're on a beach in Brazil. Mm. There are beautiful women all around us," and they start to change the.
Well, that's probably the most honest use of the art form, you know, rather than something that completely corrupts a great song. At least I think that's where the best videos probably came from, is where you leave a little room so that. You know, to me, if you make a good record, it's an audio record, you've told the listener everything you want to tell them. You leave just enough to the imagination, and that's why it works. So in that sense, videos become, you know, some growth on top of this perfect being, you know. But if you leave a little room in there or incorporate the video in the act of creation, that's probably where the highest quality stuff comes from.
Right. Richard, when you're making the record, do you think, ooh, I can see this video Never. Coming along?
Well, you know, well, who you know what I really, okay. you know what I love about making videos? Mm-hmm. Nothing.
Oh, really?
I wish I enjoyed it, and I've made a few videos that I'm proud of, but I don't find it a very creative thing for me. I like writing songs and playing with a band and making records and being in the studio. To me, that's very creative, and video making, for the most part, is sitting around waiting for guys to light things. And it's just sort of not really, doesn't do anything for me. I mean, I'm proud of some of the results and my input in the videos, but no, I just write songs, you know what I mean? I just write songs that I like, and I guess maybe I should pay more attention to videos because I've seen good records with unbelievably adventurous and thought-provoking videos that just go crazy.
Right.
But I just guess I don't, I just, I'd rather, my favorite video would be sitting here playing, looking at the camera and performing. I mean, to me, that's
where they all
I want it to be all about the song. Right. And the video is sort of an afterthought for me.
Chris,
then maybe at the end, you'd burst into flames.
That would be good. Huh? That would be good.
Maybe I watch too much MTV. Maybe then you burst into flames and then and there'd be a girl dancing kind of naked.
Kind of naked.
Come across, you know, not really naked because it's, you know, it's MTV.
But is that what, hey, this sounds like one of your videos. This could be your, I mean, when you're creating the song, do you think of the video, or is that?
I think, you know, is that when I write songs, idea? I have vision, I got a pretty good vision of what it's about, and the better the song I write, the more strong vision I have. Then usually I don't have enough money to do that, you know, it's like, so it ends up being some other kind of short form.
Okay, Michael, what they really mean is that if they could make videos and direct them themselves.
Oh, sure. I remember I did a video with Artie Garfunkel, which was the non-video of all time, which was him, I forget the song, him sitting in a chair reading a book. And that was it, one shot. The label wouldn't put it out, though. We loved it. Because we thought the idea was that then who's ever watching it, after a while, when they realize that's all they're going to get for their money, is that then we'll start to think about the song
They'll
or something else.
They'll listen to the
else.
Song, yeah.
Exactly. And it was just one shot. It's like some German expressionist movie, just Artie sitting reading a book. Whatever book he's reading, he brought out of his pocket. He had his beret on, and that was it. But the label wouldn't
get behind it. I wonder why. How could they not get behind that? Garvin reading a book?
I don't know why.
Heavy rotation, boy. That'll pull him off the air. Sure, you got all your naked chicks. I got a guy reading a book. Huh? See what the public wants.
We have to take a short break. We'll be right back with more of My Generation's Roundtable Discussion on Music Video.
Maybe he reads a book and at the end he bursts into flames.
Welcome back to My Generation's Roundtable History of Rock and Roll, where our current topic of discussion is the music video. I'm Peter Noone with my guests Michael Lindsay-Hogg, Chris Isaak, Richard Marx, and Don Was. And before we go any further, Let's look at what's happening right now in video, in the 90s.
We switched round and round till half past dawn. There was 57 channels and nothing on. 57 channels and nothing on. 57 channels and nothing on.
Is it art or is it pornography?
Well, I think after watching that segment, I think all those videos reflect the same thing, that the quantity of the information has outpaced the quality of the information. Before we discuss that, I'd like to introduce, via satellite, our guest. He's a multi-talented performer. He has a new CD out called No World Order. Here he is, Todd Rundgren. How you doing,
Hello.
Todd?
How you doing?
Are you up in a satellite or what?
That's exactly.
All right. You look very nice up there.
Satellite of love.
Hey, Todd. What do you see as far as the future for music video in the 90s?
Well, I don't see that the form has evolved so quickly in the past that we can expect it to be completely different in the 90s. There is still a fair degree of diversity. Certainly Michael Jackson's videos have this kind of Hollywood quality, and as opposed to that, there might be the information overload style of YouTube videos. So I don't think you can single out a direction. I think that the more significant change is the ability of the audience to sort of talk back to the delivery system in a way, and maybe get a little bit more of what they would prefer to see rather than a program or director's idea of what good video is.
Richard, you seen the Peter Gabriel, you know, computer-generated technology, the Peter Gabriel Steam video? Have you seen that one?
I've seen the Steam. I think maybe they were talking about Kiss the Frog, mm-hmm. which is the latest video, I think, which is almost like a ride.
It's one of these so-called motion platform rides. I've been to the company that essentially co-developed it, and it's a company called iWorks, and they make these things that are like Star Tours. I don't know if you've ever been in that in Disneyland. Essentially, you sit in a seat, and the seat moves around, so it gives you a greater sensory input, but it's not really interactive. You can't determine the scenario yourself. You just kind of go along for the ride.
Chris, how do you think this is going to affect music videos? Do you want to do a video where people go for a ride?
Todd, is it like Nintendo?
Yeah, you get big blisters on your thumbs.
You gotta put it in more simple terms for me, Todd, baby. Is it like Nintendo or is it like Pong? I don't know.
It's a Super Mario thing,
I just played Nintendo the first time, and hey, amazing.
Yeah.
I don't know. I have no idea about this kind of stuff. I don't get it. It's like, look, they don't let me push a wheelbarrow. I'm not allowed to bring your machinery there.
But perhaps Michael knows something about it. What's going to happen with
it? No,
stuff?
No, unfortunately not. I'm more with you this time. It's difficult for me to figure out how it's going to... I see how someone feeling they're taking part in something is going to be nice and interesting for them. To do with the thing itself, if it makes the work, either its commercial aspects or its artistic ones, better, I don't know. That's the puzzle to me.
Plus, do you want to have, you want to have like some, kind of rock band actually coming into your house? Do you mean actually that virtual reality of a rock band in your house? You know, your kids are asleep and it's like 2 a.m. I don't know.
Obviously, this isn't a fad. I mean, if you think there's always been fads in entertainment, there's been 3D, there's been smell-o-vision, whatever the hell it's been. This is obviously not a fad because it's due with the whole change in communications which is going on as we move toward the next century. I don't know what it's going to do to the thing, because what we've been talking about, because Todd, before you came on, I mean, we were talking about, where this all started and Elvis Presley and some guy getting up there and singing the song that he wrote and some kind of raw human being on the stage, and that's where rock and roll started as. And now it's gone on to such sophisticated levels, I don't know where the initial We're the original little bit of dirt which makes the oyster, what makes the pearl, what pearl it's going to be.
That's the exciting thing about it, though, is that
so far it's been the province of technical people and, you know, and business people who've invested in it. But as it turns now back to artists, it's a wide open field. It's like making films in 1900. Artists can make anything of this that they want to. The great thing is finding the emotional impulse that makes for a great song or a great film or whatever, and using this medium, you know, define the medium. That's what's thrilling about it. Todd did something, he's the first to do it. There's no means of comparison. It's the last frontier in this thing.
Well, I think that, you know, that the sort of apprehension you feel about learning new things is something that, you know, some people feel apprehensive about technology and just have a natural tendency to shy away from it, even though it may not be as complicated as it seems to them. And so if the new technology is going to become a valid tool for artists to express themselves in, they're going to have to understand, in the same way that the first time you pick up a guitar, you don't know how to make a G minor seventh chord or anything like that. You're going to have to invest a little bit of effort into learning some of these new things, but the rewards in the long run are that you can have a greater degree of control over the process and add new dimensions to the ways that you express yourself.
Just another technical question. The reason you can't see us is because you're on satellite, or is it because you're wearing glasses?
That's it.
Oh.
Okay. Oh, is that what's wrong?
That's it.
Okay, I'm going to have to take a short break, but we'll be right back with more of My Generation's Roundtable discussion on the music video. Peter Noone back with you on My Generation's Roundtable History of Rock and Roll. Here I am with my special guests, Michael Lindsay-Hogg, Chris Isaak, Richard Marx, Don Was, and via satellite, Todd Rundgren. Hey, Todd, just for Chris Isaak and I, would you tell us a little bit about interactive audio?
Interactive music?
While you're at it, Todd, also I'd like to know about the thing on the VCR. I got one, it's not a good one. I think it's the Eagle brand, but it says it's got like the day and the date.
Yeah.
And it's always flashing.
How do you... Always flashing. Always 12 o'clock,
that.
Right?
Yeah.
It's always 12, right?
Not at your house, I'm betting. Huh? I bet yours says whatever day, right?
Yeah, whatever. Whatever day it is, it's okay.
Amazing.
Yeah. What was the question?
We were talking about interactive music.
Don't wait for the translation, Senator.
Interactive music, yeah.
Okay. Interactive music.
Well, music has always been traditionally a linear form. In other words, it always has this very strict agenda. It starts in one place and ends in another place. Of course, jazz may not conform to that definition, but for the most part, it's something where the audience is really passive the whole time. And there are other art forms in which the agenda is determined a little bit more by the audience. For instance, if you go to a museum to look at some painting or sculpture, nobody says you can only look at it for 2 minutes, and you can only look at it from this particular angle. You have some control over the way you experience it, and the idea is to make music something in which the audience has a little bit more control of the experience. So the idea of interactive music is to allow the music to conform to a greater number of situations.
Don, if we get this interactive CD, can we like get rid of the drummer and then get rid of the singer and then we can put the first verse at the end and stuff like that?
That's actually exactly what you can do with the
CD. You can get rid of the drummer.
Basically, he's broken his album down into segments of where you can take the first verse of a song and tack it onto the chorus of the eighth song on the album. Maybe never ever listen to the third song on the album. You can choose different versions strip it down to where it's only drums and bass and vocal, or versions of the
remix
songs.
Remix it yourself.
To a limited degree, yeah.
So Richard, listening to all this, what do you think is the future, like 10 years from now when you watch VH1 and MTV, what do you think we're likely to see in videos?
God only knows.
Hopefully lots of yours.
Yeah, always hopefully lots of whoever's you're talking to. I don't know. I'm fascinated by the technology. I'm impressed with what we're able to do. But it really, for me, so far, at this stage of the game, hasn't entered into the way I create music. It hasn't, I mean, and for me, you know, I don't think I'd really want anybody to be able to put the first verse of a song at the, you know, at the end of another one, and because that's the only thing I do feel like I have some control over in my whole life is what I put on a record.
Well, that's the thing, because when Todd was talking earlier about when you go to an art gallery and you see a painting, the painter thought, well, that's the way I like it best. I like that little bit of blue up there, and I like the face of it, like Van Gogh. I like the green eyes, whatever the hell he did. This is what I like best. And what's really interesting, because Todd's explaining it very, very well, it has to be in its infancy, this whole movement of what's going to happen, because at the moment, I sort of side with Richard. I like it to be what I think is right, and then if someone else wants another way, let him go and do it himself.
I've been making music for 25 years, and I spent probably the greater portion of that, you know, having the same, pretty much the same attitude as everyone else, which is, you know, this is a very precious thing, you know, has to be exactly this way. And if I had the power to do it, I would have gone into people's homes and adjusted their stereos so that they would have gotten exactly the right spectral balance on everything, and sat them down and say, listen to this part, it's really good, you know, this kind of stuff. And we have to realize, you know, that as artists, musicians and the legacy of popular music is not necessarily to make great, huge, grand statements. As a matter of fact, it's often so much just to get laid that we're really trying to create impressions of ourselves that don't exist. And in that sense, I've gotten to the point in my life where that's not useful to me anymore. And I just assume people know exactly what I'm doing in all of its aspects, you know?
It's very exciting, but it is something completely new. I mean, I want to have a go. I mean, I'm interested in now having a go with your record and see what I can do to it, you know? I mean,
Smoke, fire, good-looking women. Those three things are going to be in every video forever. Mark my words, kids.
Oh, I thought you said that you had to smoke, light a fire.
Smoke, fire, good-looking women. They're going to be in all videos.
All right. Well, I'm afraid we've run out of time, so don't forget to come and watch us again on My Generation's Roundtable History of Rock and Roll, when we all talk about videos of the 60s, 70s, and 80s. Thanks for watching My Generation. Bye. Grammy award-winning record producer and a member of the group Was Not Was, Don Was. And later in our show, we'll be joined by satellite with Rod. Via satellite.
Would you get it right? Once again, Don Was.
Okay, here we go. Grammy award-winning record producer and member of the group Was Not Was, Don Was. And later in our show, we'll be joined via satellite by Todd Rundgren. Rundgren.
Give me this, Jesus Christ.
Todd Rundgren. Oh, Jesus. Rundgren.
Just move your mouth later to add the words in.
Thank you. Loop me, loop me.
How do they get Mr. Ed to do it? With peanut butter, isn't it?
Strings.